Thank you for joining us today, Mid-Year Economic Outlook Webinar. I'm Anthony Valeri, Director of Investment Management at Zions Bank Corporation. Today, I'd like to review the first half of 2023. We'll talk about the economy, the trajectory of the economy, and then provide an update and outlook for the stock and bond market. So let's get right into it. We'll follow that up, of course, with a Q&A session at the end. Let's start with the economy. The economy has surprised to the upside for the first half of 2023. What you're looking at here is the economic surprise index. This indicator measures the degree to which economic data exceeds forecasts and the magnitude to which it exceeds forecasts. And you can see the upward trajectory over the second quarter. Now, this is a trend that started back in the fourth quarter when the economy was expected to grow just 0.7%, but ultimately growth, GDP growth, came in at 2.6%. Then the first quarter, a similar trend, 0% forecast, but ultimately the first quarter grew 2%. And now for the second quarter of 2023, which just concluded, the expectation is that GDP is coming in closer to 2%, up from an initial forecast of 1.7%. So the economy has been resilient, it's been better than forecast, and that certainly influenced the performance of financial markets. The other main driver has been a deceleration in inflation, and this has been greeted by relief from investors, especially the most recent June print, which showed a greater than expected deceleration in the widely followed consumer price index of inflation. Now, inflation has fallen from a peak of 9.1% exactly a year ago to 3%. That is a sharp deceleration. And in the most recent report, widespread evidence of falling prices, primarily in the core CPI, which had been somewhat stubborn so far in 2023. But all of this continuing to provide support for the financial markets, and the core rate shows that weakness has been a beneficiary for the equity market and also for bond yields, which have moderated on this report. I think the gains in inflation will be harder to come in the second half, but clearly inflation has turned. More importantly, the labor market has not slowed. It slowed only gradually here in 2023. The job market just hasn't weakened, and the unemployment rate remains very low by historical context at 3.6%. You can see the change in monthly jobs. The red line represents the six-month change, how it's slowly decelerated, but it's been almost a slow-motion deceleration, and you just don't have a recession with such resilience in the labor market. So you're going to need to see some weakness there to really increase any recession odds. That hasn't happened. It's contributed to the strength in the economy at this point in the year, and again, also supported financial markets. If you look at weekly jobless claims, this is probably one of the best leading indicators on the economy and financial markets. Weekly claims turned higher this spring, only to show moderation lately, and weekly claims have turned lower. This, again, is another indicator of the health and resilience of the job market, whether companies are resilient to let go or resistant to let go of workers, given how hard it is to find qualified applicants, nonetheless reflects positively on the economy. What this has also provided is a firm base for consumer spending. And although consumer spending did slow over the second quarter of 2023, it continues to provide ongoing support. Should also mention the excess savings. You probably heard about that in the media. And those are savings that were accumulated throughout the pandemic with consumers unable to spend those savings. They're using those excess savings. And at some point, those will become depleted. There's evidence of that happening now. But we don't know exactly when that it'll occur, but it will still provide spending power over the remainder of 2023. When that is ultimately depleted, that could lead to some slowing. And then finally, let's not forget a resilient housing market, which has seen modest improvement over the last 2 months. And with mortgage rates so high, to see that resilience has been another bright spot in the economy. And of course, housing being the largest single share of an individual's wealth, in most cases, that has also provided support to the economy. But it's not all a positive story. There are concerns and warning signs in the economy. The ISM survey indices, two of the top tier indicators on the economy, are telling a mixed picture. The manufacturing index is below 50. That's the line that indicates expansion or contraction. Only the mid-90s saw a drop in the ISM manufacturing to the current level of around 46 without a recession. Now, you contrast that to the services on the right-hand side of this slide here, and you can see the services index is close to 54. That is firmly in expansion territory, and it's been that service sector that continues to power the economy along, and services comprise almost 90% of the U.S. economy, so this too has contributed to the strength of the economy. The manufacturing weakness not to be ignored, however, and we are getting some signals elsewhere to suggest that there are risks ahead, and there are significant risks to notice, and most notably with the leading economic indicators, this metric, when it goes negative on a year-over-year basis, a recession has always ensued. It's one of the most reliable recession indicators, and the message from this indicator continues to show a potential recession is a possibility. And we have to keep in mind at this point, despite the resilience of the economy that I just talked about, that we have not felt, or the economy has not felt, the full impact of the Fed's rate hikes, over 5 percentage points worth of rate hikes, or 5 percentage points worth of rate hikes since March of last year. So 15 months of monetary tightening still has an impact, will be coming through, and we have to be on guard for that. That will have an impact. So certainly a recession, not now, but it might be just delayed. We continue to think that there is a good probability of a recession, certainly 50% in our view, later in 2023 or even into 2024. Another indicator, one of the more reliable ones, the yield curve remains deeply inverted. This is the yield differential between the 10-year Treasury and the 2-year Treasury. And you can see it's negative, meaning short-term bonds yield much more than the intermediate 10-year. Again, this is always inverted ahead of a recession, usually with a significant lead time. So there are significant risks. We don't know the full impact of Fed rate hikes. So something to keep in mind. So it's been a good first half for the economy, but we're not out of the woods. And again, significant risks ahead that we need to weigh in. With that positive backdrop, we saw a good performance as we turn to investing here. A good first half for most asset classes. The S&P 500, our proxy for large cap stocks, had a very strong first half. Developed international stocks also bounced. This is a sharp contrast to 2022, which was a really tough year for investors. And as you can see, the first half of the year, positive returns across a variety of asset classes, including mid and small cap stocks, high yield bonds, emerging market equities, municipal bonds, and high quality bonds, only commodities in the negative. So a good first half. You'll notice the S&P 500 with a nice lead. I'll get more into that here in a moment. If you look under the hood, there were some notable disparities, and this really explains what happened in the first half. Significant strength in technology, consumer communication services, and consumer discretionary. That's where you see some of the big stocks. I'll get to that in a minute. But again, the more conservative areas, those dividend paying equities at the bottom, were actually negative over the first half of 2023. That is historically rare to see this kind of difference between the various sectors, and important to be aware of. If we look at how that played out, we look at the Nasdaq, where the more technology-focused area, technology-dominated Nasdaq, rather, had a very, very strong first half, up over 30%. On the left, you will see the Magnificent Seven, the seven largest companies in the S&P 500, and you can see the strength of their performance. That's an average of about 89% total return for the first half, and that put the Nasdaq on the cusp of a 95th percentile outcome for a six-month total return, meaning the last 6 months have been almost in the top 5% of all occurrences, just going all the way back to 1980. So it's rare to see this kind of strength over a six-month period. There's only been a few occasions, as you can see on the right-hand side of that chart, where the NASDAQ has performed so strong over a six-month period. Important to realize just what the technology sector did relative to the broad market. So a very strong and rare outcome for the NASDAQ and technology overall. And this raises the question, well, what about the rest of the market? And we can measure that using the S&P 500 Equal Weight Index. On the list, on the left there, you will see the table of performance showing the biggest disparity between the market cap weighted index, which is what's frequently quoted in the financial media, and the equal weighted index. And you can see 2023 show the fourth, if we ended the year today or at the midway point of 2023, the equal weight underperformed by the fourth most or the fourth largest amount since records began. You can see that that almost 10% point performance differential relative to the market cap weighted index. That is very, very significant and important to understand that gap. And if you didn't have access or were concentrated in those big technology names, you didn't match the performance of the S&P 500. On the right side of the chart, we show that that goes both ways. The equal weight index can also outperform the market cap weighted index. And you can see that 2022 was a year in which the equal weighted index did outperform. That's a year when diversification helped. That has not been the case so far in 2023. Here's another way to look at it. And this is the S&P 500 equal weight versus the S&P 500 market cap index. We index performance to the start of the year. You can see both tracked relatively closely. That's usually what happens. But starting in March and following some of the bank concerns, these index diverged. And you can see that I circled on the blue line there that at the end of May, the equal index was actually negative at that point of the year. It was only some of the larger tech companies that were positive in the tech sector generally. But that has changed in June, and the first part of July has seen the equity market rally broaden out. That's helped investors, but hasn't closed that significant gap between the two of them. So what does all this mean going forward? Well, if you look at the top five companies in the S&P 500, because of their strong performance, we have a concentration risk issue again. The five largest companies comprise 24% of the S&P 500. This is one of the highest numbers in decades. And this is not a time to go chase this market, chase those limited number of companies. It is a time to remain diversified, remain patient. Note that the broader have a diversified portfolio, even though there is that return disparity. And in fact, since the beginning of June, that disparity has narrowed out and the market has moved up together. So we would be cautious, certainly, to chase that. We would remain diversified. And here's why. If we break it down a little further, we see that equity market valuations tell two different stories. The S&P 500 market cap, a PE ratio, a more common way of measuring valuations, up around 20. That's an expensive valuation relative to history. It's certainly above average. It's denoted by the yellow horizontal line. And then the blue PE ratio, which is the equal weight, is actually just in line with its historic average right at 17. So not overly expensive, certainly not cheap, but again, a much better valuation on the equal weight index. That is also a reason why we don't see a big sell-off in stocks. If we do see one, we think it's limited to 5 to 10% because that broader market is more attractively valued relative to some of the big names in the marketplace. And we do think sentiment, which has been negative for much of the past year, which is turning more positive, is a contrarian indicator, increased some risks, but is not excessive or euphoric, which would indicate the equity market is due for a greater pullback. So our view of equities is certainly much more muted second half, mid-single digit returns, and certainly much more balanced relative to fixed income. Speaking of fixed income, Treasury yields are at the upper end of a range here that has been, we saw peak yields, depending on what portion of the bond market, back in October. And since then, Treasury yields have been range-bound. They're still at the upper end of that range. And there is more value, certainly a lot more value to be had in fixed income. Performance was positive year-to-date for the broad indices. But there is more opportunity with higher yields across the board in the Treasury market. Yields have come down recently on some of that benign inflation data. And we do think more single-digit type returns are in store for the bond market. Hard to see a material fall in yields, but still we think bonds play a key role in the portfolio. And again, better value here going forward. If the Fed does cut rates, we think that better returns are in store, or at least pauses. And interest rate futures show a 90% probability of another quarter basis point rate hike at the end of July, 50-50 beyond that on another 25 basis points. But we're getting close to the point where the Fed is likely done raising rates. And when that happens, typically get a nice tailwind for the bond market. Here's the Bloomberg Aggregate Bond Index total return after the Fed's rate hike, last rate hike, and what the total return is 6 months, 1 year, and 2 years after that last rate hike. And we show eight of the last rate hike episodes, and you'll see that performance is positive across the board. These are good performance numbers in each of those cases. So a strong historical precedent that bond performance typically improves after that last rate hike. So do think things will get better for the bond market. It's been a very tough 18 months, and 2022 in particular was difficult, but we're starting to see some light at the end of the tunnel and better valuations for fixed income. Within the fixed income market, we are not focused on high yield bonds. We're cautious there. This is the average yield spread for high yield bonds. This is lower rated debt. You can see that at the end of June, it actually fell below the historical average. And in the event we do get a recession, the high yield bond market is simply not priced for rising defaults. So while we think high yield may be supported, we don't think there's good value there given these more expensive valuations. We'd rather be concentrated and focused rather on high quality bonds. And that remains our emphasis in our investment portfolios. And then a common question that we receive is that I think investors debate with currently is why buy intermediate bonds when short-term bond yields more due to the inverted yield curve? Well, some interesting data, if you go back to 1989 and the start of the Bloomberg 3 to 6 month T-bill index, you'll see that intermediate bonds compared to T-bills over the following 12 months when the yield curve was inverted usually outperform short-term bonds. Now, that seems counterintuitive that a lower yielding bond would outperform, but the main driver of that is that ultimately after the Fed paused, rate cuts ensued and a recession occurred and those intermediate bonds witnessed price gains. In fact, very positive performance after that. You can see the average total return differential was almost 5% versus the 3 to 6 month T-bill index, and 93% of outcomes were positive. So some compelling evidence to remain diversified, focus on intermediate bonds, maintain that diversification in the event we do get a recession. For more on this topic, please take a look at our recent Market Moment video, which was released in mid-June, that goes into more detail on buying intermediate bonds when short-term bonds yield more. Thanks everyone for joining. Rebecca?
All right. Thank you, everybody, for joining us today. I'm Rebecca Robinson. I am the Director of Wealth Management, and I have the pleasure of taking Anthony through the Q&A. So, Anthony, let's start with, at the beginning, we had some better than expected information, but then we still see there's a potential for a recession. And one of our questions is, do you see a recession on the horizon? And I think even a bigger question for us is, what is a recession and what does it mean for an investor?
So we do think there's a significant probability. I would put it at over 50%, just over 50%. You can't say it with real specific probabilities, but we think it's a significant risk. We don't want to ignore what some of these main indicators like the yield curve are telling us. I'm not a believer and this is different. So as an investor, what do? You still stay invested. You don't try to time the market. The stock market bottoms before the recession is over. You never know when it begins or is over. And our expectation is that it's a mild recession. There's still many positives in the economy. We've seen it in the first half. So we would manage around it. We've taken some cautionary steps in our investment portfolios. And that's been, I think, tough for a lot of investors, just given how some of those big tech names have really rallied. But we don't want to chase it. We don't want to take that concentration risk. Remain diversified and don't try to time the market. If you are particularly sensitive to investment losses, consider a more conservative approach, which does include a little bit more in the high quality bond market.
And I think that leads to our second question is, all right, we see a recession, maybe there's a market downturn. What are the things I should do to prepare? And part of what you just touched on, I think, goes into this, which is, do you have the right allocation? Are you more risk averse maybe than in the past? But are there anything someone should consider doing if there is a market downturn on the horizon?
No, I think you touched on it, Rebecca. You know, maybe if you are sensitive, go to a more conservative allocation, but you can't time these things. It's impossible to do so. And the best way to do that is remain diversified. And diversification could limit your upside in cases. We saw that over the first half. but it never gets blown out in those adverse market environments. So it's important to remain that diversification. Don't try to time it. That includes some international, that includes bonds. That's the best way to play it and not try to get in and out of the market. Unfortunately, we've seen too much in our wealth management group, the clients who do try to time the market, and then that ends up hurting them over the long term.
Now, one of the things you covered also was around sectors, and particularly which sectors had performed, outperformed, underperformed. This question is around which sectors do you think will perform well in the next 10 years?
The technology has been a great performer over the last 10 years. We've looked back in our department over the sector performance for strong bull markets, and it always varies. The leadership is varied, and this is going back many, many years. So it's hard to find one that does particularly well. Certainly, you want to skew to those that are more cyclically oriented in an expanding market and vice versa. But to come out and pick a single sector, we just can't do that. And I think the knee-jerk reaction is, well, technology is the wave of the future. Technology is being incorporated by all sectors and all industries across the board, and they're all benefiting from it. So to say that one single sector is going to outperform, no, we don't buy that. I think it's very important to remain diversified across sectors.
You know, another question we get quite often, especially when we're worried about a recession or a market downturn, is what are our thoughts and expectations around things like precious metals, gold, silver? Should I be out buying gold and putting it in a safe deposit box? Should I have exposure? You know, how do you react to that?
That's a common one, Rebecca. And in the April of this year, that was a very common question. Gold had a very strong run. We don't use gold or precious metals in our allocation. It's hard to determine a value. They don't pay interest, no dividend, there's no earnings. So how do you value it? It's one that is tricky and inherently volatile. So it's not really appropriate in diversified portfolios. It could maybe be a speculative play. So we don't incorporate it based on those items. And after that euphoria, or certainly sentiment shift on precious metals in April, gold has pulled back as inflation adjusted yields have increased, which we think is a potential risk given that they're higher, and we'd rather be in stocks and bonds than precious metals.
Perfect. All right. This is a question around interest rates. And as you talked about, there are some rate hikes that are already priced into the market. And then what happens when rates peak? But part of this too, I think what we've seen, for the first time, we're seeing real returns on cash and things like that. And we're starting to see people doing a little bit of what I would call timing the fixed income market, much like people try and time the equity market. So the question is, where do you expect interest rates to peak? Do you expect rates to fall thereafter? And if then, how quickly after the peak will they fall? So do we time our way into the fixed income market?
That's a tough one. Timing the bond market, not something no one has ever done. We may have already seen the peak in the bond market. The 10-year peaked out in October of last year. I don't know if we'll exceed that. I think if we do exceed that, it may happen later in the second half, but I don't expect it by much. I think that we are close to a peak, especially with the Fed hiking rates, inflation coming down. The risk to bonds would be, do investors demand a greater premium against inflation in the future? Should inflation prove sticky? But I think at this point, given how much more bonds yield, I think you can ride out that volatility with a diversified bond allocation that's short, intermediate, a little bit long, and to make sure you're diversified across bond sectors. Really tough to time. And we've seen a couple examples here in the past year of trying to time the market. Late September last year, no one wanted European international, thinking that the war in Ukraine, natural gas prices was going to lead to severe recession. And that ultimately didn't pan out, and those stocks did well. So really hard to time. With fixed income, you're getting paid to wait. So trying to time it is especially detrimental. And use that interest income, if rates do go higher, to reinvest and lock in future higher rates. So yeah, wouldn't try to time it. I think if we're not at a peak, we're pretty close to one now.
Great. Well, we have another national election not too far off. And one of the questions here is, what trends do you see economically surrounding this election? But really, I think a bigger question is, how do we see elections, especially national elections, impacting the market and maybe the strategy that people deploy?
One area that I don't think is getting enough attention now is certainly being talked about, but not getting enough attention is two things, and they're interrelated. One, the interest expense on the federal debt is rising rapidly, and that's going to take a bigger and bigger chunk out of government revenues and out of government spending and what they can, again, throw back into the economy. It also means that deficits are likely here to stay, and the deficit has been increasing as of late. So in the event we do get a recession or a slowdown in the future, and this is more around election time, the government, in my view, fiscal response will be more limited. We won't have as many levers to pull there. That means, does the Fed do more? Does growth stay sluggish for longer, just given the fact that there isn't as much discretionary spending available due to that higher debt interest expense, and also the fact that deficits are likely to become more of a persistent issue in the future? Well, time will tell. We're still a ways away from that, but I think that's an issue that'll become more important as we draw to the next election.
And I'm sure something we will be talking about quite often over the next couple of years. All right. I love this question. This question is, do you have any investment advice for a first-time investor who is 18 years old? I want to start by first congratulating you for being 18 and even thinking about investing, but we talk a lot about time horizon, asset allocation, but Anthony, if someone's 18 and really heading into investing for the first time, any advice for them?
Yeah, we really believe in asset allocation being the best way to invest and grow your portfolio over time. Certainly for someone that young, a long horizon, you'd want to be all equities, but be diversified. Don't be lured into the next or the current, hot topic or investment du jour. Unfortunately, crypto got a lot of attention in April of 2022 and turned out to be a bad investment. There are similar stories like that throughout history. So don't chase the latest hot fad. It may seem a little boring, especially for someone that young, to look at just a diversified portfolio, but it is really the best way to get invested, and try to set aside something you can contribute every month to that diversified portfolio and watch it grow over time. That's the best way to get started, grow your portfolio. And then as time progresses and you have more, maybe more options available to you in terms of other investments, be it something more exotic. But I think that's the best way to get started, and certainly always maintain a core of a diversified portfolio.
Yeah, and I think that's great. Starting early, but as boring as it sounds, diversification is the primary driver of how your investments will perform. All right, this one flips over to another topic we're hearing a lot about. And what is your take on a potential credit crisis? What does that mean for us?
So I don't think that does come up in the media. I don't think we'll have a credit crisis. I do think we'll see rising defaults. I don't think we've seen the full impact of the Fed's rate hikes. I don't see companies over leveraged like we saw way back in the 2000s. Don't see some of the leverage in housing related items like we saw in 2008. So I think for the most part, corporations are on better footing, but rising interest costs in a slowing economy could have a negative impact. We will see rising defaults. And there will be a negative impact. I don't see a full-blown credit crisis developing. I just don't see the macro data right now to support that. But yes, I see rising defaults in the future as we get a slowdown, probably less so than priced into the market, but a widespread credit crisis, no.
All right. And then, Anthony, I know we've received several questions about the Bancor itself, Zions Bancor Corporation, and where we are in terms of our performance. And I would encourage everyone, Zions Bancor Corporation will release earnings after market close on July 19th. So I think all of the questions you have should be answered in that earnings release. And with that is the end of our presentation. And while we present this to give you great information and some thoughts about how we look at investing, we're also always here to help. So if you have more questions, if you would like to connect with one of our wealth advisors, please join and look at your affiliate website. And there is information there on how to contact wealth management. And with that, thank you so much for joining, and we will see you in a few months.